De Broglie proposed that as wave-particle duality exists for photons, that is light, the wave-particle duality must exist for each and every type of particles. So he said there is a wave associated with every moving particle and wavelength of that wave is given by lambda equal to h upon p, where p is momentum, h is the Planck's constant. We can divide this de Broglie hypothesis statement into two parts. First part says there is a wave associated with every moving particle, and the second part says wavelength of that wave is given by lambda equal to h upon p. So lambda equal to h upon p is called as de Broglie relation. The first part of the statement was justified by using Bohr's postulate. So using Bohr's postulate, the existence of wave associated with the electron revolving in circular orbits inside the atom was justified. And the second part of the statement, which says lambda equal to h upon p, was justified by using Planck's relation E is equal to h nu and Einstein's relation E is equal to mc square. But both these justifications cannot be accepted as firm evidences, because Bohr's postulate is a postulate, it is an assumption, and lambda equal to h upon p de Broglie relation was obtained only in case of photon using E is equal to h nu and E is equal to mc square. So some firm experimental evidence was needed so that de Broglie hypothesis can be accepted. The experimental evidence should show the existence of wave associated with some particle other than photon, and the wave associated with that particle should have the wavelength lambda equal to h upon p. Number of attempts were made to find the experimental evidence which can show the wave associated with the particle and to calculate the wavelength of the wave associated with the particle. Davidson and Germer experiment was one of the attempts. So let us discuss this Davidson and Germer experiments and how the result in Davidson Germer experiment confirmed the existence of wave associated with the electron, and how the results in this experiment confirmed the correctness of de Broglie relation lambda equal to h upon p. So here you can see the experimental setup of Davidson and Germer experiment. In this experimental setup, you can see an electron gun. It consists of a tungsten filament. The electrons are emitted by the thermionic emission. When we pass current through the filament, it is heated, and due to thermionic emission, the electrons are emitted. One anode is placed over here. This anode is kept at positive potential. So this anode accelerates the beam of electrons in the downward direction. This anode is provided with one aperture in it so that a fine beam of electrons can be obtained. Now the idea of the experiment is to get diffraction pattern by using the beam of electrons, because if there is a wave associated with electron, that wave must produce the diffraction pattern, and to produce the diffraction pattern, what we need is a diffraction grating. So here a target in the form of a nickel crystal is used as a diffraction grating. So here we are using the grating as a reflection grating. So nickel crystal is used as a diffraction grating. The electrons are made to fall on this nickel crystal. The electron beams will get reflected from different atomic planes inside the nickel crystal. Then one collector or detector was used to collect these electrons which are reflected from the nickel crystal. This collector will collect the electrons, and these electrons are grounded through the galvanometer. So this galvanometer will show us how many electrons are being collected. The current in the galvanometer will be proportional to the number of electrons that are collected by this collector. Now there is a provision to move this collector and collect the number of electrons at different angles. So this collector can be kept here, and the number of electrons in this direction can be noted. It can be kept in this direction, and the number of electrons in this particular direction can be noted. For each position of the collector, the current in the galvanometer is noted. This current noted in the galvanometer is a measure of intensity of the diffracted beam of electrons. So what is done is simply an electron beam is made incident on a nickel crystal, which is used as a diffraction grating over here, and the intensity of reflected beam is noted at various angles with the help of this collector and galvanometer. This procedure was repeated for different values of voltages maintained between the anode and the cathode, and a graph, polar graph, was plotted between the current, that is intensity of the electron beam, and the angle between the incident and diffracted beam, this angle. This graph showed two peaks separated by a minimum. Two peaks separated by a minimum confirm the existence of wave associated with the electron, because two peaks separated by minimum means diffraction has taken place. Without diffraction, two peaks would not have been obtained. So the existence of two peaks separated by a minimum confirm that diffraction has occurred, and diffraction cannot be explained by using particle theory. So if diffraction has occurred, that means there must be a wave associated with the electrons. If wave is not associated with the electrons, then only one peak would have been obtained. But the existence of second peak indicates the diffraction has taken place, and the diffraction has taken place means there is a wave associated with the electrons, because without waves, diffraction cannot occur. So this confirms the first part of the de Broglie hypothesis. With the electron, there is a wave associated. So we have shown that for a particle other than photon also, there is a wave associated. The experimental results show that for a voltage of around 54 volts, so when V is equal to 54 volts, the electrons scatter more prominently at an angle of 50 degrees with the direction of incident beam. So we can say the first order maximum is obtained at an angle of 50 degrees. So these values of V and phi will be using for calculating the value of wavelength. So let us first calculate this wavelength of the waves associated with electrons by using de Broglie relation. So lambda is equal to h upon p, p is momentum, h is Planck's constant. So p is a square root of 2 me. So e, energy of the electrons here, is e into v. V is the voltage, 54 volts we will use here, because for 54 volts the prominent maximum is obtained. So lambda is equal to h upon p, that is equal to h upon square root of 2 mev. H is Planck's constant, which is 6.626 into 10 raised to minus 34 joule second. M is mass of the electrons, 9.1 into 10 raised to minus 31 kg. E is charge on the electron, 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb. So by using all these values, the wavelength lambda is calculated, and it was found to be 1.67 into 10 raised to minus 10 meters, or 1.67 angstroms. So using de Broglie relation, the wavelength of the wave associated with electrons is calculated as 1.67 angstroms in this Davidson-Germer experiment. Now let us calculate the wavelength of the wave associated with these electrons by using some other relation, Bragg's diffraction law. Bragg's diffraction law is already established law in physics. So if the wavelength calculated by using this Bragg's law of diffraction matches with de Broglie wavelength, which is calculated as 1.67 angstroms, then we can say the de Broglie relation is correct. So let us calculate the wavelength by using Bragg's law of diffraction. So Bragg's law of diffraction is given as 2d sin theta equal to n lambda, where d is the width of the slit. In this case, it will be the separation between the two atomic planes, gap between the two atomic planes. Theta is the glancing angle. So theta is the glancing angle means it is the angle between the incident beam and the atomic plane. So this is the angle theta. Now what will be the value of this theta? This phi, we have seen the angle between the incident ray and the diffracted beam is 50 degrees. So phi by 2 will be 25 degrees, and therefore this theta, the glancing angle, will be 90 minus 25, that is 65 degrees. So we will substitute theta to be equal to 65 degrees. The interplanar spacing D for nickel crystal is 9.086 into 10 raised to minus 11 meters. So D is used as 9.086 into 10 raised to minus 11 meters. And the maximum is obtained for the first order. So this N, order of the maximum, is taken as 1. Using these values, the wavelength lambda is calculated, and it is found that the wavelength lambda is 1.65 into 10 raised to minus 10 meters, that is 1.65 angstroms. So just recollect the value calculated using de Broglie relation, it was 1.67 angstroms. So the two values calculated using de Broglie relation and Bragg's law of diffraction match to a close proximity, and therefore what we can say is, if Bragg's law of diffraction is correct, then de Broglie relation must also be correct, because it is also giving us almost same value as given by Bragg's law of diffraction. This is how Davijan and Germer experiment confirm the second part of the de Broglie hypothesis also. So in the first part, we proved that there is a wave associated with electrons by obtaining the diffraction pattern, and in the second part, we proved the correctness of de Broglie relation by matching the wavelength obtained using de Broglie relation with the wavelength obtained by some other law, which is Bragg's law of diffraction in physics. So as the two values of wavelength match, if Bragg's law is correct, then de Broglie relation is also correct and proved. So this is how Davijan-Germer proved de Broglie hypothesis, and de Broglie hypothesis was experimentally verified. But this de Broglie hypothesis in Davijan-Germer experiment is experimentally verified only for the electrons, which are very small particles which move with very high speed. Now, because in case of electron, the wavelength calculated is around 1.65 angstroms, and the diffraction grating, in which width of the slit, that is this interplanar spacing of nickel crystal, is of the same order, around 1 angstroms. Therefore, it was possible to perform this experiment and get the diffraction pattern, because to perform diffraction experiment, the wavelength of the wave used in the experiment should be comparable to the width of the slit in the diffraction grating. Now, if the wavelength is very, very small for macroscopic bodies, if you calculate this wavelength, it will be very, very small, and the diffraction grating in which width of the slit is so small may not be available, and therefore the existence of wave associated with macroscopic bodies, bigger bodies, may not be possible. So the experimental verification of the wave nature of macroscopic bodies may not be possible, because diffraction grating in which width of the slit comparable to wavelength of the wave associated with such particles may not be available or is not available. Thank you for watching this video. If you like this video, then please subscribe to the channel so that you will get timely intimation of new videos uploaded to the channel. Thank you very much.